And take a moment to turn your Bibles. There are Bibles in the pews. The page number is in there, 659. Or it's Ecclesiastes chapter 3, starting with the first verse. Familiar passage of scripture to even people who never darken the doors of a church, because a group named the Birds made a hit song out of this passage back in the 60s when I was a toddler. Okay. If you believe that one, there's a bridge in Brooklyn. I'd like to just read verses 1 through 14. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. Time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent and a time to speak. By the way, I have a note in my Bible that says time to be silent and a time to speak, and I underlined a time to be silent, and I wrote, I'm not good at this. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. What does the worker gain from his toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on men. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the hearts of men. Yet they cannot fathom what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for men and women than to be happy and to do good while they live, that everyone may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all his toil. This is the gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken from it. God does it so that men will revere him. Father, just guide our thoughts and our hearts and my mind as we look into this passage of your word and share some very personal things with our church family. Anoint this time by your Holy Spirit, Father, we pray. In the name of our Savior Jesus, amen. We all know that seasons come and go in every area of the world, even New England. Eventually, winter will come to an end. I mean, it came to an end officially about a week and a half ago, I believe, but eventually, winter will really come to an end. We might have snow this coming week. Who knows? Okay, yeah. Well, with a name like Winters, I like it most of the time, but I've had enough this winter, I'll tell you. But you know, winter really does end. Connie and I walked around last Thursday night. The sun was out. That bright orb that we sometimes don't recognize in New England, that bright thing in the sky in the daytime. And of course, it stays later now, light later. And so we were outside in our yard, and Connie had already started raking leaves off some of the crocus beds and the tulips and daffodils. So I went out and helped her because she's the brains and I'm the brawn, and I can get a lot more done if she shows me what to do, where to rake, and where to dump it. So we were having a great time looking at these tender little plants come up as signs that spring is coming. There's a promise of new birth and new life. I'm going to stick more to my notes today than I usually do because I want to make sure I say certain things the way I feel God wants me to say them. This is not an easy message to give because it involves some very real transitions for me, for Connie, and for all of you. I'm calling it changing seasons. This is a season for everything in life. And so I'm sharing this message with you from God's word and from my heart, because I know that there's a very strong possibility that most of you have already heard that I gave a letter to the church cabinet a week ago, Thursday night. And one thing I love about our church is everything discussed at cabinet, any of you who are members are welcome to attend. It's open. So anything that's said in cabinet, there's no secret between the pastors and the cabinet, unless it's something very, very personal that needed to be discussed about an individual or a family's needs. So I know that the word has been getting around, but some of you may not be aware. So I want to read, actually, you know what? I didn't bring the letter with me, so I guess it's God's will that I not read the letter. The letter is on the back in the foyer. I submitted a letter to the cabinet, and don't gasp yet, but I submitted a letter in expressing my intention and Connie's intention to retire from the paid ministry here at the church at the end of August. Okay, now did you hear what I said? To retire from the paid, full-time ministry here at the church. And there's a lot of reasons for this, and I'm going to share some of them. But as God's word says, to everything there is a season, and a season for every activity under heaven. I want to go back in time and just, some of you have a pretty good idea of my biography. You've been here enough times with me. But I want to go back in time real quickly to the seasons of my life and Connie's life. The beginning seasons, Connie was not in my life, but she was in my life. Season one was 1950 to 1963, and that's when I was not a believer. My mom and dad and my brother and I were having a great time camping, fishing, hunting, all kinds of things. We had a close-knit family, a lot of love. But I'll tell you that something was missing. And that something was our faith in Jesus Christ. My mom had that. Her mom had that. My dad's mom had that. But my dad and I didn't have that. And so as good a dad as he was at that time, and as friendly he was, and as much as he took us places, that dimension was missing. So I wasn't a believer. I knew at times I had that sense, that God-shaped hole that we talk about. I had that sense I was missing something when I heard my grandmother or my mom talk about Jesus, but I really wasn't sure if I wanted it, and I wasn't sure I really was missing it, or if it was just because mom made me feel emotional sometimes. Then season two, 1963, most of you know my brother died in a car crash in August of 63, along with his best friend, Jack McCarthy. My mom's mom, Little Nanny, who lived with us, died at the age of 78 about a month later in the same hospital. October 6th, 1963. By the way, Con, I looked up the dates in the year date calendars, you know, that you can go back in time online. October 6th, 1963, I've shared with some of you before, Connie's Sunday school teacher encouraged her to start praying for her future husband. Does God answer prayer? October 13th, 1963. Does that sound kind of close to October 6th? I went to an evening service at my church, probably about the third evening service I'd ever been to in my life. Pastor Russell Christian, that's his name, led me to Christ. He had preached on, if I was the only sinner, if you were the only sinner, and you were the only sinner, God loves us so much that Jesus still would have come to die for that one person who needed redemption. And that hit me. And I went home that night, and I prayed in my bedroom. I believed in Christ. And then I went out and watched Bonanza with my mom and dad. 9 o'clock Sunday night, Bonanza, okay? Dun, 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 dun. If you have never seen Bonanza, kids, you got to give it a shot. A pretty good show. Season three. February 14th, 1970, I meet Connie Lorraine Buchholz from Wellsville, New York. And By the way, she's been spending the past 6+ years praying for me, her future husband. And I meet her on Valentine's Day, and I'm telling you, I know that Christians discuss is their love at first sight and all these things, or do you have to grow in love? Well, there was love at first sight, and then there was growing in love, because we just clicked from the first time we met. From the time she looked at me taking a drink from the water fountain during the tour of East Hall, and she looked at me and she watched my Adam's apple go up and down, and she said, "You're sure drink funny." July 71, about a year and a half later, I took Connie up to Letchworth State Park, one of our favorite places in the entire world. If you have never been to Letchworth State Park, you owe it to yourself to go there. They call it in New York the Grand Canyon of the East. It is gorgeous. It is much more natural than Niagara Falls, three beautiful waterfalls, and the perfect place to pop the question, which I did. And she said yes. And so that was the beginning, another stage, season three. I have to share this with you. Hopefully Connie won't throw something at me. But I didn't clear this with her, so, you know, ladies get ready to, or guys get ready to protect me, and ladies get ready to cheer her on as she gets her back at me. But I asked her to marry me. We were going to go out to the nicest restaurant in the whole area, which happened to be called The Castle in Olean, New York, where St. Bonaventure University is. They actually had some stuff there, not like Houghton, New York, which has nothing almost except the college. So we were going to go there for dinner, but we were just so excited. Neither one of us was hungry. You ever been there? I mean, we couldn't even think about sitting down eating a meal at that point. So we went to the market basket in little old Fillmore, New York, and bought a bunch of bananas. And I think we each had 2 bananas for our engagement day lunch. And then we went home. This was 4th of July week, and my mom and dad and her mom and dad, they knew I was going to pop the question. They came and said, we came home a little earlier than they expected us. They'd just gotten back from the 4th of July parade. And they said, "So did you have a nice meal out?" And we said, "Well, this is Pastor Ken. Not Connie didn't say this. I said, well, we weren't really hungry, so we decided to buy a bunch of bananas and monkey around." Upon which Connie and my mom both turned bright red. Like she is right now, probably. Shaking her head at me, okay. By the way, we didn't monkey around, okay. We kissed. All right. Season 4, August 19th, 1972. Connie and I are united in the Christian covenant of marriage at Hallsport Community Church by her pastor, Reverend Twining, and by my pastor, my mentor, Reverend Russell M. Christian. We went to seminary. I got my MDiv, my Master of Divinity degree, and she was awarded by Gordon Conwell with a PhD. Putting hubby through. Seriously, they gave her an award, and it was well earned. Season 5, 1976, I spent a year being mentored by Pastor Christian in Troy, New Hampshire at the Trinitarian Congregational Church, a sister church in heart to this one. Same kind of mission statement, same kind of thing they were aiming to do in God's kingdom. That was less than a year, but it was so important. He took me hospital visiting. I saw how he prayed and related to people when they were hurting, dying. I learned a lot from him. He was a more quiet man and a more quiet preacher than I am, and I learned a lot about listening, which I'm still learning about. Season 6 was right here. October 1st, 1976, I was 25 years old and came as youth pastor, responded to the call from this church, and stayed until December 31st, 1983. We had Light Shine First and Make It Clear and True Direction and a guitar club and all kinds of things besides youth group and people like Susan St. John and Beverly Shipman and Kay Combs and Dave Swekla and a whole bunch of people. We would take and rent an entire Christian camp, either New England Keswick or Happy Tea Ranch, it was called, up in New Hampshire at Romney Bible Conference. We'd rent the whole place and bring somewhere between 60 and 100 teens with us. And we'd have our own staff of like 13, 14 counselors. And some years we even had our very own lifeguards. Tony DeBrino was one of our lifeguards. I remember that. And so that was an exciting time. And in that period of time, on January 22nd, 1979, Laura Marie Winters came into the world. And on January 22nd, 1983, Emily Elizabeth Winters came into the world, both born on my grandmother's birthday, who had gone home to be with the Lord in 1973. And don't try to convince this pastor that she didn't have something to do with the dates that they were born on. Both the same day, 4 years apart, her birthday. And then for a while, we said our farewells here and we went in the Navy for 20 years. But we stayed in touch with this beloved church, because this is our church. My home church, I know no one. This is where I'm home. North Brookfield is where I'm home, and Connie's home. And so we've been here since April 1st, 2004. Can you believe that? Over 10 years. During the years I was in the Navy, Bernie Salvaggio married our oldest daughter, Laura, and in 2007, Emily met Matt. So I began my time here as associate pastor. I'm going to share at the very end some of my favorite things about serving in that capacity. But on September 1st, according to the letter I submitted, my retirement begins. Not retirement from ministry, but retirement from paid ministry. I mean, I may do a funeral and a wedding and preach somewhere and get a paycheck from that to add to our funds, but God, because Connie and I were willing to spend 20 years in the Navy, 6 or 7 of which I was away, that's a big sacrifice. Some people in the Navy, Marine Corps, and Air Force spend more than that percentage away, half of their time away. I spent about a third or so away from my family. But because we made that sacrifice back then, we have the wherewithal to not have to be collecting a paycheck anymore every month or every two weeks as it is. Now, what does it mean and what does it not mean? First of all, I want to ask a question. How many of you are leading a Bible study or a small group? Raise your hands. Or are going to? How many of you are on a church committee? Raise your hands. Okay. How many of you are involved in the youth programs, Sunday school, our Christian ed programs, youth group, Ignite, Junior Kick, Boys Brigade, and God's Girls Rock? Raise your hands. Have I missed anybody? Is there any other category that... Praise teams. How many in the praise teams? Hi, Mark. Okay. Choir. How many in the choir? I want to ask all those people who've raised their hands to stand up, because I want to say thank you. Could you please do that? I know that you don't draw attention to yourself. Folks, these are the ministers. Dave and I are the pastors. These are the people doing ministry in this church. Who does special music? I see Ed just sitting there. Who does special music? That's a ministry. Would you stand up if you're not standing already? Okay, thank you. All right. You look around you, that's a lot of people, and we're missing some that aren't here. Thank you very much. Let's give them a hand. My retirement from paid ministry doesn't mean we're not going to continue participating in the ministry here. We are not leaving. Can you say that after me? Not leaving. Okay. We're going to be here as long as God wants us here. We are not leaving for the foreseeable future. If we ever did move, it would probably be in connection with a move by our children. That was probably, we love our house, we love our community, and we love our neighbors. And it's a great place to be. It's where God has led us. It does mean that Connie and I will be away more, visiting family that I haven't seen in years, cousins, her cousins, traveling the country, seeing some friends from Navy days that I haven't seen in ages. That's the kind of thing it's going to mean. So sometimes we just won't be here. It doesn't mean I won't perform weddings. Drew, you're all set, okay? And so you don't have to worry about me saying no. You know, that's in October. No, I can't do that. By the way, we got to start getting together, okay? We haven't done our pre-marriage stuff yet. Or funerals. I've already been asked by some people who know they're getting older, Pastor Ken, would you do our funeral, my funeral? And I have notes on those services and everything. For me personally, it means that I'm going to devote more time to writing, both fiction and perhaps Bible study stuff, Bible study books to be used in our church and in other churches. And those are things I've not had time to do. It also means I may prayerfully pursue music ministry with a dear friend named Mark Elliott, who played guitar with me today and sang, or others as the Lord leads. I do believe there's some more songs waiting to be written in my heart that I haven't written yet, and I haven't taken the time to write. One main thing it means is, and you need to know this, is I'm going to back off from most pastoral counsel because my doctors have told me, you should do this if you want to be around another 5, 8, 10 years. Somehow, Dave is able to process pastoral counseling stuff and go on and leave it with the Lord, and I leave it with the Lord, and what do you think I do sometimes? Take it back. And so I just have never, you know, I've been in ministry over 40 years. 39 years as a ordained pastor, and Connie and I were involved in ministry all through seminary and all through college before that. That's another 8 years. Okay, so 47 years I've been doing this, listening, and there's some things I just can't deal with anymore. I will till the end of August, but it's already like a breath in me, that I know that isn't going to be a normal, everyday part of my life in the future. I will never stop proclaiming and praising the name of my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I will never stop singing his praises. Woe unto me if I preach not the gospel, Paul says. And there are going to be many seasons in which he calls me to do that. Perhaps I'll do some retreat ministries. I don't know. That's up to him. One thing I want to share with you. This is kind of like a charge to the congregation. Yesterday I was here for Alex Orsi's Eagle Scout ceremony, and I was able to speak at that briefly, along with some other really distinguished folks from the state government and everything. And at one point they gave a charge to the Eagle Scout. A charge being a challenge, a thing to hang in there, to keep doing what you're doing. And here's my charge. Those of you who stood up, keep ministering as long as God gives you the strength and the physical and mental and spiritual ability. Those of you who didn't stand up, because maybe you're brand new here almost, or you just haven't started doing ministry here, I pray that in 5 years you'll be able to stand up if somebody asks you that. because you will have plugged into something that is vital for you and for our church in ministry. You will have found your spiritual gifts and found your place and time of ministry. One other thing, giving. You folks for 10 years have given faithfully so that I and Connie, we could be here and live comfortably. You have been amazing. 140, 150, maybe 160, 70 on a good Sunday, sometimes 110. And you have provided support for 2 full-time pastors. Well, that's going to come to a close on August 31st. But don't stop giving. Imagine what this church can do to bring honor and glory to our God if you and I continue our current level of commitment in tithing and giving offerings unto the Lord's work. First of all, we need to fix up our buildings, folks. Before the parsonage falls down, we have to do something with it, okay? So we need to have a fundraiser, and this will help give us a head start. And perhaps there's other things that God wants us to do that we haven't even thought of. There may be things that God wants us to do in terms of a facility for youth ministry that we don't have right now. I don't know. That's between our church and our pastor and the Lord and the cabinet and the Lord. Now, I'm going to just take a couple of minutes and tell you what some of my favorite things have been. These are a few of my favorite things. We mentioned the praise bands, the growth of involvement in our music ministries. Look at how many people God has given us with musical gifts and talents. We don't all have them, but I think we can all appreciate them. Guitar players galore, piano players, singers, choir members, at a time when many churches no longer have a choir because there's not enough interest. And I think our choir is having more fun than ever. I know I am. I think I'd like to say we're singing better than ever, too. I mean, I really believe that. I really believe we're not perfect. We make mistakes. We sing sour notes. I do anyhow. But the music ministry has just been incredibly growing, not because of anything I did, but because of what you are doing and what God's doing. The scope of Kick and Junior Kick ministries over the years, those who have been faithful in those ministries have seen scores, hundreds, maybe 1,000, I don't know, teens come through those ministries and hear the gospel. And I believe many of those who maybe have drifted are gonna come back. They're gonna remember when they're in their 30s and trouble comes and that baby is ill or whatever happens, that they need Jesus. They need a church family. The amazing ministry of One Way Cafe and One Way Jam that God has given Ron to lead. The hyper generosity of our people that I already mentioned. The multiple gifts of teaching and preaching the word that many in our fellowship clearly display. This last Wednesday, Ron Olson, he preached last Sunday here at Dave's request. He preached this past Wednesday at our Lenten service. If you weren't there, you missed something really, really special. And after the message, let's see, is Bruce here? Bruce Herholtz, are you here? There he is. He's back there with the beard. Well, Bruce is speaking this coming Wednesday night. Excuse me. And after Ron was done, Bruce came up to me and said, "Man, he really raised the bar pretty high." And I said to him, "Yeah, I'm sure glad I spoke before he did in this series." Connie's young adult class that varies in numbers, but I know has meant a lot to our young adults that come to that class. And then the growth of the small group ministries, which have just kind of exploded to God's glory. And I do thank Judy and Jack for their leadership in that and for their encouragement to me in seeing things happen beyond my vision for it. Yesterday, I don't know, we had like 16 people. There were a couple who couldn't make it that were planning to come, but 16 people over at the parsonage, all small group leaders currently, or people who know God wants them to lead a small group in the near future. Isn't that something? That's over 1/10 of our regular attendance, folks. You know, and some people come into these small groups do not come here on Sunday morning. So that's an outreach as well as something that benefits our church body. So we're not saying goodbye. We're saying hello to a new period, a new season in our lives, season number 9. I tried to make it 7 seasons because I'm a Mickey Mantle fan, but I came up with 9. Whose number is that? Ted Williams, yeah. So, see, you Red Sox fans did this to me. I have 9 seasons. All right. I would ask that you pray for the ministry of the church, and that you especially pray for the youth group. And that's not just a True Direction reunion, Connie, okay, and other members of the, it's youth group, Light Shine, Make It Clear, True Direction, from the 70s and 80s. And if you think you should be coming anyhow because you were in 1990, come on out and join us. That's going to be open to everybody in the church. It's going to be a potluck ham dinner. We'll supply the ham, and the rest of it's going to be potluck on Saturday, May 3rd. I ask you to pray for that event because I think it has the potential to bring some of those folks who were young people in the 70s and 80s back to their faith in Christ. There are many who are still serving Him faithfully. Praise God. We have some of them right here. But then there are others who've drifted. They've made bad choices. They might have gotten into drugs or alcohol or who knows what. They may be discouraged and depressed, been divorced 2 or 3 times, living with somebody and that didn't work out. But they're getting these invitations, and I pray that a lot of them come. And they think back to what the joy they had in Christ when they were here. God's word says, there is nothing better for men and women than to be happy. I would say happy in the Lord. Joyful in the Lord is a better word. To be joyful and to do good unto God's glory while they live. That everyone may eat and drink and find satisfaction in his toil or her toil. Not just your work at work, but your ministries. Find satisfaction in the ministry God has called you to. This is the gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken away from it. God does it so that men will revere Him. I know that everything God does will what? Endure forever. Everything He's done through Pastor Libby, through Pastor Bitter, through Pastor Snell over a century and a half ago, everything He's done that is His work will endure forever, because you and I, through Christ's grace, through God's grace, are going to be with Him forever. But I pray, as I prayed before, that as long as Jesus tarries, and I say, even so, come, Lord Jesus, amen? Come now if you want to. I'm ready, by your grace, not my strength. But even so, come, but as He tarries, I pray this church will continue to be a beacon of the gospel in this area, in this community, to the glory of God. And what God does will last how long? Will endure forever. Let's pray. Father, thank You. Thank You for making my words that have come out of the mouth better than the words that were on the paper. I pray, Lord, that You would take this message and just continue to have us walk in Your joy and peace together. Lord, forgive us when we fail. We know You do. Your grace is bigger than any mood we can have, any bad word we can say, anything we can look at in the internet or on TV that we shouldn't be looking at. Your grace is bigger than all of that. But also You call us to a life of holiness in Christ. You call us not just to give You more to forgive, but to be faithful as You are faithful to us. Lord, help us to conform more to the image of Christ as individuals and as a church. May all the glory and honor be unto God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen. To quote Maynard G. Krebs, now I'm going to get misty. A lot of you don't know who that was. Okay, I thank you. I asked Connie to come up with me, but you know that Connie's place is not in the public eye. It's privately serving Jesus in the background to his glory. Thank you so much for that. It means a lot. I don't need it to keep serving him, but it does spur you on to want to do more in his kingdom. Thank you.